in the struggle, I found strength for the fight. We'll raise the banner high until we break the night. With spiritual armor, for the weapons of this warfare are far from carnal, but mighty in God, but tearing down strongholds.
Let me see those Bibles. If you got them, hold them up in the air, whether it be paper or digital. Hold up your sword. This was what I was talking about right here. This is the sword. Let me see the word. Let me see the word. Say word. Now say sword. This word is your sword. This is how you tear down strongholds. I'm going to be talking over the next few weeks about learn to fight. Learn to fight. If you're taking notes, write that down. And this is it right here. This is your sword. You are against a battle that is equipped with a weapon. He's described as a roaring lion. He's described as a adversity that has darts. He's described as many different things. But he has certain weapons in his arsenal, but none of his weapons can compare with the power of the sword. This sword that we have cuts to bone and marrow and separates to the very core in the spiritual and in the physical. This word is powerful. If you love the word of God, say amen. If you believe the word of God, say amen.
Amen.
If you're ready for the word of God, say amen.
Amen.
If you're just feeling good, say amen.
Amen.
Look at your neighbor and say amen.
Amen.
Now, some of you guys say it amen so many times, you're like, I don't know what that even means. Amen is like an old school way of saying I agree. So you might be like, word up or something like that. You know, somebody like, word up, cracker or something like that. That's your amen. But here's the deal, in upper room, you gotta talk to me, you gotta communicate back to me, okay? So you can say yeah or word, or some people, man, just like, right? If you feel something that's good, you don't gotta know what you're saying. You're like, right that. Little lean. If you're gonna do the I'm teaching you, don't go because people think you got gas or something like that. You gotta do it like at the message, okay? Don't just be grunting because then your neighbors think you're weird, all right? But I need participation. So one more time, let's all pretend like you're just feeling it right now and you're just gonna say amen or you got your grunt, but you gotta have your catchphrase. I love going to churches. When I was in San Diego, I went to a church that had soul. And my pastor down there, his name was Miles McPherson, okay? And man, he's a brother, right? He's black. And so he's like, he's got all these things that he does. He's like, word. I can't do it all deep like he does. It's bad, though. I'm like, oh, I want to be like Miles. He's so cool. He's awesome. But I can't do it. But some of you guys in here, you got your thing, right? Whatever it is. For me, I'm like, I just like, dang, man. Sometimes people are preaching. I'm like, dang. Sometimes I go to churches and pastors don't know me. They say something good. I'm like, dang. They're like, stop. I'm like, no, it's good. Keep going, man. Come on. All right, so ready? 3, 2, 1, do your sound. Huh. Somebody over here is like, huh. I like that. Like, huh. Jesus. Have you ever been in a fight? Ask your neighbor, have you ever been in a fight? Okay, if they said yes, that's good conversation after upper room when you go out to eat. If they said yes, ask him about it. But right now, let's get into the word, Daniel chapter 1. Open your Bible to Daniel chapter 1. I'm going to be in Daniel 1. I'm going to read a large portion of it. I'll be in Daniel chapter 10, and I'll reference 9 as well, okay? So we're going to be primarily in Daniel tonight, and we're going to just kind of pull out and get an example from Daniel, who's an amazing, amazing man of God, who, in fact, I want to show you something tonight. Daniel's fast, we're getting ready to fast, actually influences us right now. In fact, it influenced the founders of our country. And in fact, there was a certain king that Daniel mentored and trained that did something that had ripple effects all the way into the formation of America. And so I want to talk to you about that in a minute. But right now, I want you to think about a fight. Think about a fight, all right? Maybe you've never been in one, but I guarantee you've probably been in a situation where you felt in danger and your adrenaline rushed. Have you ever been on like a roller coaster that you were terrified of, or maybe been in the ocean and the wave got a little too big? Or maybe like me, like if you see a big old dog, have you ever come around the corner and you see a big old dog standing there just growling at you? How many of you guys have seen that situation, right? And you're not sure if it's on a leash or if it's free, or if you've ever been walking like through Oildale, you just see dogs roaming around, right? My sister lives there, and I go visit her sometimes. I'm like, why is there dogs here? Why are they free? Who do they belong to? Somebody needs to catch that dog and get it out of here, right? And so on one of those circumstances, I'm a little afraid of dogs. I was there, and I'm out there playing with my nephews, and all of a sudden, there's this pit bull coming down the street. And I'm like, I got my nephews, I got my kids here, and this thing's just coming down the street, right? And I'm like, oh, dang, like that sense, right? You ever get that shot up your spine? It's like a cold shot of adrenaline. I'm like, I'm gonna have to wrestle this dog to the death. So I'm getting ready. I'm looking around. Is there sticks? Is there rocks or nothing? There's nothing. I'm like, bear, I'm gonna punch this dog. Uppercut, like, boof, right in the face, right? And some of you are dog lovers. I have a dog too. I love dogs. I do. But a pit bull roaming with my little nephews and my little kids, I'm like, heck no. Heck no. All right? And I'm thinking maybe I gotta sacrifice my arm and it's gonna bite it. And I'm gonna karate chop it. Maybe I'll be like Caesar, like the dog whisperer, and be like, shush, shush, shush. Come here, come here. How does he do that? Quiet down, doggy, quiet down. I was gonna Caesar Milan on him. Doggy whisperer. He's got like Jedi dog tricks, right? But this thing was snarling and everything like that, so I'm like getting all ready, right? And all of a sudden, I see its owner come running up, and it sees me. I'm like, ready. I'm ready, okay? I don't know what I'm gonna do. In my mind, I got kicking. I got headlocking. I don't know. I could put it in like an arm bar, like dog arm bar or something. I don't know what I'm gonna do, but I'm gonna do something to this dog, right? And so the owner comes up. He sees me like that. He's like, what's wrong with you? It's just a dog. I didn't even respond. I was like speechless. You got a giant pit bull on the loose and you walk up to me like, what's wrong with you? Yeah. And even if he said something that I like to hear, the tone of his voice made me annoyed. One of those guys like, hey, it's just a dog and dogs have rights too. It can walk down the street just like you can. And I can kick it in the teeth as well, right? So I've always had like a little issue with dogs. One time, me and my dad was a pastor. I got adopted and we had a bus route. We picked people up for church, right? So we had this bus route and my job, cause I was little and I was fast and he was old and he was fat, was to go into the yards with the dogs and knock on the door. And this was my assignment, right? I was like 5 years old. I have an assignment. I got to knock on the door and get out, right? I had a whole plan for it. I got to jump the fence, whatever. And when you're five, every fence is like over your head. So it was a big deal, right? And so I go up, knock on the door, and I look over, and there's a big old dog. And it's not on a leash, and I'm on its porch, right? And it was like this moment of slow-mo. And it's growling like in slow motion. It's like, I swear, it was like Sandlot, you know, like the beast dog. And it got up, and it got up, and I was like this tall. I was like, bleh, 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 bleh. And it's like right there, and I see it slobber, come down. No, that didn't happen, I'm just kidding. But it was right there, and it got up. And I'm like, oh dang, I gotta outrun. And I seen the Sandlot. I was like, I gotta outrun this Sandlot moment. This is my time to shine. And so I took off and I'm peeling out. And I was actually, it probably looked more like this. To be honest. Because I look on the bus and, by the way, my dad was on the bus and Amy was on the bus. My soon to be first grade girlfriend, by the way, on the bus, looking at me, screaming like a girl, running. And I run, and I hit the fence, and I just go, boof, and I go over the fence, and I fall down, and I look behind me, and everybody's laughing. And I look, and where's the big dog? There's a big dog. It was like a porch with like a concrete thing like this. I didn't see, but the big dog was chained on the porch, and nobody else saw the big dog. But there was this chihuahua that came from the backyard, and then it chased me all the way to the fence. And so everybody on the bus thought I was running from the little dog. I'm like, no, there's a big dog. Okay, Joey, there's a big dog. They're all laughing. I'm like, shut up, you guys are dumb, right? I'm all mad. So to this day, if you ever meet my dad, you could ask him about the time I ran from a chihuahua. And he swears there is no big dog and I'm afraid of chihuahuas, right? I'm like, you give me I will punt a chihuahua. I've never been afraid of a chihuahua. Anything that is puntable, like, go. I'm not afraid of that. Even then, I wasn't afraid of no chihuahua. And obviously you can tell I got issues, I need some counseling, okay? So, if you've never been in a fight, fights do something to you. They shoot adrenaline into your body, they give you tunnel vision, and if you're not prepared for a fight, you will not function properly. Your body goes into like kind of overdrive, and it sends adrenaline and strength to all of your major body parts, so your finer movements, even gripping, becomes difficult. And that's why fighters train themselves for that moment of the fight. They train their bodies, muscle memory, they train it to punch in a certain way. If they're into grappling or jiu-jitsu or different sports like that, they train themselves on the locks over and over and over and over until they have muscle memory on those punches, right? And I never did any like karate or anything. Like technically, when I was in sixth grade, I did the YMCA karate. They're like, huh, 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 right? So if you ever try to fight me, I'm gonna do like, shh, back to YMCA, right? Yes, sensei, huh. You're gonna get beat up with that stuff, right? You're gonna get beat up if you ever took YMCA karate. But I remember I did YMCA karate and I had my gi on, right? I had my belt on. I remember one time after karate, man, I was walking home, I was just mad dogging everybody. You see what I'm wearing? You don't even know. I could have been training from birth. I was eyeballing people. And I grew up in South San Diego. I was like the only white kid in my whole neighborhood, right? It was all Hispanics. They're probably like, oh, el loco, right? These güero es loco, homie, come here, right? So that was me. And that's kind of experience. Throughout my life, I had some fights. And in fact, one time I actually got jumped. I got beat up. And in that moment, I remember, man, I never ever want to be in a moment where I'm not prepared for a situation like that again. So I actually, in high school, did a little bit of training. Don't try to fight me because you'll probably win. I said a little bit of training, right? Every time I say something like that, everyone's like, dude, I'll take you right now. I'll take you right now, dog. Okay, you will. Fine, you win. I lose. Okay, there you go. But I wanted to be prepared if that moment ever happened again. Now listen, in the physical, some of you guys might have been in a fight. You might have been in a situation, maybe a verbal altercation, right? So maybe you got in a verbal altercation and somebody just said a cutting thing to you and you didn't know what to say. And then you're on your way home. You're like, oh man, I should have said that. You're like thinking of all this stuff to say. You're like, oh, if they ever say something again, I'm gonna have boom, zinger, 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 your mama, your daddy, your grandpa, boom. But in the moment, you're just like, your face. I remember in third grade, man, one time, we had just moved to San Diego, and we were sitting at lunch, and all of a sudden, all these kids around me, I went to a ghetto school, and they all start telling yo mama jokes. I didn't realize they were playing. I didn't realize it was a game. And so they start telling yo mama jokes, and I'm like, oh, dang, somebody about ready to get in a fight. So I'm eating my mac and cheese like, oh, yo, he said your mother is fat, oh dang, right? And they're coming up with all these things that are just blowing my mind, like your mama is so fat, she works at SeaWorld on the side, like all these, I'm like, oh my gosh, these kids are geniuses. It was my first day at school. I didn't realize they sat around and practiced these every day. So when they got to me and they started talking about my mom, I was like, well, you have never met my mother. I know that for a fact because I just moved here, so who's stupid now? You said, my mom is so stupid, but you don't even know her, so awkward for you. This guy over here is talking about my mom. I mean, and everybody's sitting there looking at me like, what's wrong with this guy? Then I realized it was an insult, and I'm like, wait a second. You need to stop that right now because my mother is a classy lady. And she deserves to be treated like a woman. And she's a nice lady. And I took my mac and cheese and my apple juice. I went to another table, right? The only table I could find had like some girls and these guys and nobody was talking. And I sat down like, hey guys, how you doing? And they're just looking up at me like, and they went back. So that was my third grade experience. So I got some yo mama jokes on lockdown if you ever try to blast me. Because something about being in a fight makes you want to be prepared. I hope you realize tonight, I'm not just talking about fights for fun. I'm trying to take you on a journey. I'm trying to open your mind because maybe one of these situations I just talked about, you can identify with. And here's what I want to say. You have been in a spiritual fight since the moment of your birth. Just because you haven't seen it, just because you haven't sensed it, there are situations, there are obstacles that you face. There are generational curses and bondages. Some of you are in poverty. Some of you are in spiritual poverty. Some of you guys have addictions that you can't break and sin habits and different things that just haunt you over and over and over. And I want to let you know tonight, many things that you deal with are in fact a spiritual assignment against your life. Stick with me tonight. I want to take you over the next few weeks on a journey and show you, just pull back the curtain and see what's going on. I want to open your eyes to the heavenly realms and let you understand that there are spiritual battles taking place all around you, all around Bakersfield. Even in this place, there are angels on assignment here tonight. There are angels on assignment over your life. There is principalities and spirits that truly do battle. And you can be a bystander, you can be another casualty of war, or you can learn to pick up your sword and swing it, and you can learn to chop down some devils, take off some heads, cut off some evildoers in the name of Jesus Christ. Whenever Jesus was attacked by the devil, he was fasting. Jesus was on a 40-day fast, and he only drank water. He was praying. He went off into the desert. I'm not asking you to do a 40-day fast of only water. That is why he was out secluded in the desert, because when you do that, you're drained and exhausted. And I'm asking you tonight to make some sacrifice. Jesus was on a fast when the devil came to him, and he used the word of God. The devil tries to pick up the sword of the word, but he uses it wrong. He's like flailing it around. He doesn't know how. And Jesus wielded it back accurately. You need to know the word of God. And the problem is, some of you guys will believe anything anyone tells you, especially the devil, as he whispers in your mind, because he knows the Bible better than most Christians. I want to know the word of God better than my enemy. I want to be more equipped than my enemy. And here's the special ingredient that he don't have. I have the word and I have the spirit. Not only did God give me the word, he gave me the most incredible sidekick, like Batman and Robin. But in fact, I'm Robin, I just think I'm Batman, right? The Holy Spirit is your, think about this, the God of all creation sent the Holy Spirit to be your comforter, to be your assistant. That's crazy to me. Like, you wanna assist me in my assignment? That is an incredible God. You know, 2 Corinthians 10:4 says, the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. That means physical, carnal, what you can see. But mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, spiritual strongholds. Some of you are facing the same trial over and over because you will not realize that it is a spiritual trial that you're facing. I want to look at Daniel. Daniel is an incredible man of God. And I want to read you a passage out of chapter 1. Turn with me, if you will, to Daniel 1 and verse 1. You can do it on your YouVersion Bible. It'll be on the screen, or you can turn in your Bible. Whatever way, I want you to read this for yourself and get this inside of your spirit. I want to tell you a story here. Verse 1. In the third year of the reign of Jeroham, king of Judah, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came to Jerusalem and besieged it. And the Lord delivered the king of Judah into his hand, along with some of the articles from the temple of God. These he carried off to the temple of God in Babylonia, of his God, lowercase g, by the way, and put in the treasure in the house of his God, lowercase g. Now, I want to kind of go on here, but I had you turn to that passage because I want you to read that. And in fact, if you follow along with us on the 21-day fast on YouVersion, tomorrow you will actually read this passage. And each day it will assign you a reading. So you could do that now if you want in your YouVersion app. If you don't have it, get it. So here's what happened. Daniel was taken along with who we know as Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, the guys that went into the fiery furnace. And he's taken to Babylonia, right? This was the king of the whole world, the known world at this time. And the king had selected the most handsome and the smartest and the most talented people, and he had brought them to his kingdom because he wanted them to be trained for his service. Okay, so here's where I pick up the service. Among those chosen were some from Judah, that's Daniel, And then we know them now as Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. You probably know that better. The chief official gave them new names. To Daniel, the name Belteshazzar. To Hananiah, Shadrach. Then we have Meshach and Abednego. But Daniel resolved, or the word in your Bible might be vowed. Circle that, resolved or vowed. Circle it right now. Not to defile himself with the royal food and wine. He asked the chief official for permission not to defile himself in this way. The vow, that word vow, is synonymous with fasting. He was on a vow to God. And I want to submit to you this. Those of you in here that want God to trust you with great authority and power, he will never trust someone who cannot keep a vow that they've made to God. When you are fasting, you are vowing to God. We are saying for 21 days, we are committing, we are vowing to you, not to Pastor Joseph, not to Upper Room, to God. I want to become closer to you, God. I want to be equipped for your service. And he goes on here. Now, God had caused the official to show favor and compassion to Daniel. But the official told Daniel, I'm afraid of the Lord my king who has assigned you food and drink. Why should he see you looking worse than the other young men your age? Then the king would have my head because of you. So they must have been eating really great food. This was the best cuts of meat. This was the wine. This was the best drinks and the best food. And they are wanting them to become strong. They are going through physical training. They're going through mental training. They want these people in the service of the king to be the best looking, the strongest, and the most intelligent. So that's what they were doing. There was 3 years, right? They were in a program that was equipping them for the service to the greatest empire of that time. Daniel then said to the guard whom the chief official had appointed over him, please test your servants for 10 days. Give us nothing but vegetables to eat and water to drink. Then compare our appearance with that of the other young men who eat the royal food and treat your servants in accordance with what you see. So he agreed and tested them for 10 days. So Daniel fasted for 10 days. This is the first recorded fast in the book of Daniel, and there's others. At the end of 10 days, they looked healthier and better nourished than the other young men who ate the royal food. In your translation, it might say fatter, healthier, but it's not talking about like they were fat. They were more strong, their muscles, they were more developed, they looked healthier, their skin looked better, and it says here that they were better nourished than any of the other young men who ate the royal food. So the guard took away their choice food and wine, and they were to drink, and they gave them vegetables instead. Now, I want to pause. Some of you might be doubting whether you should fast. You're doubting, you're like, I'll do the social media portion of it. In a little bit, we're going to delete all of our social media apps for 21 days. But you're doubting, should I fast? Maybe you are getting ready for a sport, or you're getting ready for some career or some job or some assignment. Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were getting ready to serve the king of the entire world. They were going into the service of like the president. If there was any time that shouldn't have been a great time to fast, it was right then. What if we get skinny? What if we lose our strength? What if? Not only could they lose their job, their livelihood, their sport, or whatever you're concerned with about not fasting, they could lose their head and their life. And in fact, probably their families as well. And yet Daniel said, no, I'm going to fast. I'm going to pray. I'm going to trust that God is not going to let me become weak and anemic as I step out for him. I want to let you know, some of you need to trust God. You know, people are not dying from fasting. People are not getting sick and diabetes from fasting. Diabetics are at epidemic rate. People are not getting these health problems because they're fasting. They're getting these health problems because all you eat is junk. You can't put away Taco Bell and McDonald's and fast food and all these processed junk, and you don't think that God can sustain you on fruits and vegetables for 21 days? I bet if you'll do this for 21 days, you'll be stronger and healthier and better equipped than you've ever been in your entire life. But we're so advanced. Ooh, I understand nutrition, and I'm a nutritionist, and I understand you gotta have your proteins and your carbohydrates, and you gotta take electrolytes at 10 minutes after your workout, blah, 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 shut up. This is about trusting God. This is about trusting the one that made your body, that breathed life into the dirt that your body is made out of. Don't you think he can sustain you if you'll honor him in a fast? And if you're just going to do the social media portion, I honor you. Maybe you're new and it's your first step. I want to just commend you. I'm so proud of you. But I know, I feel, and I've talked to many of you, you're pushing back against this fast and you don't want to do it and you have struggled with this. I would challenge you. This is exactly what you need to do. You need to step out. You need to learn to fight. Verse 18, at the end of that time set by the king, which was how long? 3 years. The king had set 3 years for this time. They were in training for 3 years. The chief official presented them to Nebuchadnezzar, the king. He talked with them, and he found none equal to Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. So they entered the king's service. In every matter of wisdom and understanding about which the king questioned them, he found them 10 times better than all the magicians, enchanters, in his whole kingdom. Now, the word magician and enchanters there, that was the state of the art. That was doctors. That was their pinnacle of science. This was their most learned men. These were the wise men. These were the leaders. So they're not just like Merlin, like, poof, ha-ha, king, look at that, right? When it says magician and enchanter, these were people that knew how, they knew medicine. They understood potions. They understood how to, like many of our modern medicines, pharmacies. We go to the pharmacy, comes from the Bible word pharmakeia, which is also a link to a lot of different things I won't talk about right now. But they understood medicine. They understood, these are the men that you went to if you were sick. And this was the pinnacle of their science, right? I trust God's word beyond anything else. Because God's word has stood for thousands upon thousands upon thousands of years as our world's pinnacle of science, state of the art, has changed every few years. It used to be every 100 years. Now it's about every 10 minutes. Our knowledge is doubling. I think God's got some stuff figured out that we don't got. God's ways are beyond our ways. This is a good time to say amen. So they fasted 3 years before they were called into service. Maybe you're going to do this fast for something that is appointed in your life in another time to come. Maybe in 3 years. Maybe you'll be done with school and you'll be at an interview. And this fast, this moment right here, is preparing you for that moment that's going to enter you into the king's service. Maybe you're going to stand before a politician, a doctor, a lawyer, and God is going to have you appointed for a task of influence. But he can never let you into that position until he knows that he can trust you. God, I trust your ways. Even when I'm preparing to go into service of the king, your ways are beyond the ways of any kingdom, any financial system, any way of the world. I might have a bank account, and I have thousands upon thousands of pennies in it. I don't trust my bank account. I don't trust the ways of this world. I love my country. I think it is the greatest country that has ever existed. I do. I really do love it. There's a whole lot of things wrong with it right now, but I do love my country. But someday this country will fade away into history. I am a citizen temporarily of my country, and I will serve my country the very best I can. But I am an eternal citizen that is not in a democracy where I get a vote. I am under a king who is eternal, and his word reigns in my heart and in my life, and I will live according to that kingdom. I will live according to that system. I will follow my God's economy. I will follow my God's rule. By his rod and his staff, he guides me. By his word, he directs me. His righteous right hand is my comfort and my strength and my shield and my defense. He's my strong tower. He's my Alpha, my Omega, my beginning and my end. And someday I will not stand before a judge and a jury and let them decide my fate, even if they send me to jail or take my life, because I will stand before the great white throne of judgment, and I will look at my king as he says, well done, my good and faithful servant. Enter into everlasting upon everlasting. Somebody shout about that. Now, we started this story with Nebuchadnezzar, and now many years have gone by, and Daniel is an older man, and Daniel is now in the service of the king Cyrus. Everybody say Cyrus. I want to show you why we're going to do 21 days. 21 days. Here we get into Daniel Daniel chapter 10, verse 1. He's in the third year of the king of King Cyrus of Persia. At that time, I, Daniel, mourned for 3 weeks and ate no choice foods. Once again, that word mourn is interchangeable with fasting. Mourning is humbling yourself. It is fasting. Fasting is humbling yourself. So he was fasting. He ate no choice food, no meat or wine, touched my lips, and I used no lotions at all until 3 weeks were over. Daniel, I want to pause because you need to understand something. I want to show you something incredible. He fasted for 21 days. Why 21 days? Well, 7 is the number of God. It is a number that is synonymous with heaven. It is angelic, it is godly, and it is holy. The number 7, there is spiritual representation around numbers, and 7 is the number of God. 3 is the number of perfection. The Holy Trinity, Father, Son, and Spirit, it is a triune being. It is a perfect being. Perfect. 7 is how much? Oh my gosh. How many of you guys were a product of the Bakersfield school system? What is 7 times 3? 21, right? So he fasted for 21 days, 3 weeks, 3 7s. This is a perfect fast. This is a breakthrough fast. Some of you have been facing generational bondage, generational sickness, assignment on your life that can only be broken by fasting. In fact, Jesus said that. There was demons that his disciples were trying to cast out and they couldn't do it. And they went to Jesus, why can't we do it? And you did it. He said, because this only goes out by prayer and there are some spirits that can only be taken out by prayer and fasting. So Daniel, understand this, came into service under Nebuchadnezzar through a fast. Daniel then goes into service under Cyrus in a fast. Now, Cyrus is incredible. Daniel was his mentor. Daniel was his elite wise man. Daniel was the one that was writing law. He was at the top of the legislature. Not only that, he had military power. He had power to judge, jury, and executioner. He was an incredibly influential man, Daniel was. And he mentored the king of the entire world, and he fasted. Cyrus is the one who ended captivity. In fact, on the second floor of the United Nations is something called the Cyrus Cylinder. You can Google this, which is written in Hebrew, influenced by Daniel, under the rule of Cyrus. This was the first Bill of Rights ever. In fact, even Thomas Jefferson speaks of the cylinder when writing our own Declaration of Independence. The formation of our nation has roots back in this Hebrew cylinder. Hebrew. Why would there be a Hebrew cylinder from the time of Cyrus, indicating that people have rights, that slavery is wrong? All these things, it's amazing. Daniel's fast rippled all the way into the formation of our nation. What could God do with you if you would dedicate in your heart to say, I am standing up. God, I'm going to give you a holy fast. Lord, I am dedicated. I want to have a life that has a ripple effect. I am so passionate. I don't want to live and die and just breathe and just take up space and just, there lies Pastor Joseph. He was a good guy. I want my life to ripple through my children. My daughter's here on the front row, into her children, into my grandchildren. I want it to echo if the Lord tarries throughout time. I want to have an influence like Daniel had. I want to be a man of integrity and of power and of influence so that when the king needs something, he would call on us. Listen, Christians. We're not just supposed to be some weirdos in a church singing kumbaya. We are supposed to be nation shapers. We are supposed to be shaking our nation. But what we're doing right now as a church nationwide is folding our hands. Oh, it's getting so bad. Oh, what are we going to do if our guy doesn't get elected? What are we going to do if they pass this law? Oh, California's in such a mess. Bunch of whiny sissies. Pick up your sword. Learn to fight. We are more than conquerors. The enemy is terrified. that there's a group tonight that might just wake up and realize who they are. I see a picture in the spirit of you tied up. You ever seen that picture of the giant and he's tied up with those little strings, right? And he could just get up and he could just break loose. I see this over you and you're laying there crying. You know, in the circus, they have these huge elephants. And these huge elephants, from the time they're babies, they take a rope tied around their neck and they stake it into the ground really heavily. And the little baby elephant tries to get away, can't get away, can't get away. As it grows, that stake is always around its neck until it's old enough to rip it out of the ground and run free if it wanted to. But it doesn't do it because it doesn't believe that it can. Because what about last time I pulled on it and it hurt my neck? And I remember when I was little and I tried to get away and I tried to do it and it never worked. And this massive elephant could walk away. And in fact, oftentimes when they're older, they just take the stake and kind of tap it in. Elephant, it won't even try. As soon as it feels the slightest pull, it just goes back and it submits. Some of you have been beat down so many times. The first time the enemy comes and just pushes back a little bit, you're like, okay, I can never be free from that addiction. I can never live a pure life. I could never have a good marriage. I could never make it through school. Because after all, you feel that little tug again and you submit like that massive elephant. And you just let your life be in captivity. God needs you to escape captivity, break off the chains, and run free. Because there is an enemy. He's prowling around like a roaring lion, seeking who he can devour. He's equipped with weapons of warfare, and you're a tied-up giant. The Lord is enlisting you tonight through my voice. Listen to me, O Christian soldier. Rise up and enlist in the army of God. As the band comes, I want to say there's no better time in the whole year to fast than right now. First of the year, it's the third, and that's kind of cool. God's perfect number, starting on the third. I think that's special. And it just so happens that 21 days from now happens to be another Sunday night. As we enter this fast tonight, we're all going to do it together. And then on that Sunday night, what's that, the 24th? 24th? We're going to come back. And that afternoon, I'm going to turn this place into a banquet hall. And we're all going to bring food. We're all going to chip in. And we're going to break our fast together. And we're all going to eat together. And that night, instead of me preaching, we're going to have worship. And we're going to have testimonies from you. Because you're going to see signs and wonders and miracles and healings. God's going to, listen, some of you have been struggling financially. And you haven't been able to break through. You're going to have financial breakthrough, some of you. I'm not promising it to every single person. But I've done fast like this many times, and I know well enough to know that there will be breakthrough. Signs and wonders, miracles, healings. Some of you are facing healings, and you need to just break through it. Now, if you struggle with fasting and you have a special diet prescribed by your doctor, by all means, please talk to your doctor. But I want to tell you one testimony. My wife, she was in Bible school. And by the way, my wife's an ordained minister. She went to Bible school just like me. She has the same credentials as me. Many people don't know that because she's just humble and amazing. But she was in Bible school, and she was fasting. And this woman, one of her mentors, said, "I can't fast." And Lisa, being young and ignorant, said, "Why?" She said, "Well, I'm a diabetic. I can't fast." And Lisa, once again, being young and ignorant, I don't recommend you do this. You might be liable. Said to her, "Well, why don't you just fast and God will heal you?" And the lady was like, "Hey, I'm your mentor, right?" And Lisa, being young and ignorant, let me say that again. I'm not saying go tell everybody to just fast and it's going to cure their diseases. But I believe this was a God ordained. Because after that 21-day fast, our friend Debbie Ross, you can look her up on Facebook and ask her yourself, Debbie Ross, Clearwater, Florida, fasted and she was cured from diabetes. She lives a healthy life now. She's in Clearwater, Florida, one of our best friends. God healed her. I've seen people that were in financial ruin at the end of the 21 days set free. I've seen people with just like habitual issues of lying or pornography or sin of some sort that they can't get free, and they just get free from it. I've seen it. I have faith for you. Even if you don't have faith for yourself, I have faith for you. I dare you, if you don't even believe me, fast anyways. Try me. I'll believe for you. You just obey. As we close, I want you to note a couple things. Number one, when Daniel fasted, he protested the system of the world. Much like when we give our tithes and offering, it doesn't make sense. When I give my tithe, I say, I am protesting the economy of this world. It's not of this world. It is of a higher place. God's kingdom is upside down. Given, it will be given to you. When you feel attacked, pray for people. Humble yourself and you'll be lifted up. It's all switched up in God's kingdom. Now, I want you to realize Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego prepared themselves for the future furnace as well. Do you think that they would have been ready to stand at the furnace and be thrown in if they wouldn't have prepared themselves in advance? See, you have to dedicate in your heart before the moment comes. You have to know the fight. And sometimes, gentlemen, the fight has pretty lips and a nicely shaped body. You better know what you're gonna do before the moment arises and you find yourself alone with little miss. Are you prepared to act in that fight? You're like, oh, dude, I'm ready to fight. I'm ready to fight. You think some demon's gonna come out of hell? Sometimes the demons are the prettiest ones. Young man, if you could see what was behind that pretty little face, I bet you'd run. I bet you'd run if you could see 10 years down the road when she controls and manipulates and destroys your life at every turn. I bet you'd run. I believe God wants to send you an angel, young man, outside and inside. Are you prepared for that fight? If you don't make up your mind right now how you're gonna react, I'm gonna tell you how you're gonna react. You're gonna give in to temptation. Because temptation feels really good. Young woman, how are you going to react when that perfect man is before you, or maybe that perfect job that you've been dreaming of, and all you have to do is just compromise a little bit? Just give up that church thing. I mean, it's the perfect job. Sundays are off limits. You can pray in your own heart, right? When you're at that interview, and you're in that fight, how are you gonna react? I'll tell you how you're gonna react. When they say six figures, you're gonna say, thank you very much. If you don't know how you're gonna fight, you're gonna get beat up. Because the spirits don't come at you with horns and a pitchfork and say, hello, I'm the devil, let's fight. No. The enemy's smart. He uses cash. He uses shiny things. Look at this new car. Look at this great job. I'll give you influence. When the devil came to Jesus, what did he do? Did he say, let's fight, Jesus? Ha ha, kung fu, right? No. He said, Jesus, you're hungry. Turn this stone into bread. He said, Jesus, come on. If you throw yourself down from the heights, surely the angels will catch you. He took him up to an exceedingly high place and looked over the kingdoms of the world and said, Jesus, listen, I will give you all of this. I will make you king and ruler over all the world. You're like, how could the devil say that to God? You don't understand. This world is under the domain of the devil because we being Adam, you being Eve, we are all Adam and Eve. We gave dominion to the devil of this world that was ours. We were the kings of this world, but now the devil is. We are aliens walking a foreign planet, but we have the authority because we are ambassadors. We carry the seal of the kingdom on our foreheads and on our arms. We are bound for heaven. So you don't have to be captivated. You don't have to be bound up. You don't have to be dependent on some guy or some girl or some job or some degree or some letter behind your name to ensure your success. All you have to do is say, Dad, I'm your son. I'm your son. But in the kingdom, you act different. You talk different. You walk different. You do things different. In the kingdom, we do things like fast. We do things like give. We live generously. We bless those that persecute us. We pray for those that do us wrong. We give to the needy. We give to the hurt. We go out and we find the human trafficked and we save them. This is what the church is supposed to be. The church is not a country club for Christians. It's a hospital for the broken. The church is not a country club. The church is an army. It's a barracks. And I am your general. And I'm saying, army, we have an assignment. God has shown me the plan for our city, and I'm calling on any soldier right now that's ready to enlist as your general over Upper Room under the Master General that is God. I am the under shepherd under the Master Shepherd. I say rise up right now. If you're ready to fight, I want you to stand up. I want you to stand to your feet and say, I'm enlisted. I'm joining the battle. I'm ready. I'm ready to fight. As you do that, and I don't want to pressure you, I don't want to manipulate you. If you don't feel this, stay right where you're at, because I am enlisting an army. This is not a typical Upper Room altar call. This is an army of God. I need infantry. I need specialists. I need special ops. I need Navy SEALs. I need the Air Force. I need every warrior that is ready. God's given you all an assignment. He's given you a spiritual weapon that's unique. Some of you guys are snipers and you have focused prayer. Some of you guys are specialists that we need to mastermind this. The war is the broken and the homeless and the hurting and the impoverished and the people that even fill the successful buildings and their bank accounts have six figures in it, and yet they're in spiritual poverty. The war is on for their soul. I will not be a bystander. If I am injured, I'll be injured in battle. And when I stand before my king, give me a purple heart. I want to go out fighting. This is my city. If you're ready to fight with me, if you're ready for the army, if you're going into this 21 days, you're committed, and you're ready to delete your social media apps for 21 days, or you're going to do that and you're going to fast. Maybe you're going to do a full fast, or like me, you're going to do a Daniel fast. I'm going to do vegetables, fruits. You could even do soy proteins and pea proteins. There's a lot of different things you can do. I'm not just calling you to give up cold turkey. I'm going to do what Daniel did. And give up sweets and breads and coffees and wines and meats and all that stuff. And I'm just going to focus on God 21 days. That means no Netflix and chill. That means no Hulu. That means no TV. That means no movies, those entertainment things. What that means to me is worship music and Bible. I wanna go in like a special ops. You know the Navy SEALs? The Navy SEALs, they have an 80% fall off rate, but they come out as the baddest mamma jammas on the planet. One of my friends is a Navy SEAL, he's bad. He committed to an assignment. I want to separate myself from the world for a minute. And guys, I'm gonna do it too. And I love social media. I enjoy Instagram and Twitter and Periscope. I was just doing it right here because this is my last moment. I love all that. But I'm gonna step away from all that with you. I'm gonna fast, I'm gonna pray. I'm gonna pray for you as your leader. So if you're ready to do that, don't feel the pressure. If you're new or you're a guest and you don't wanna do this, that's fine. I'm talking to the army of God. I enlist you now. Come. Sign up right here at the altar. Come on. I'm not gonna make you sign anything. This is a spiritual sign up. This covenant is between you and God. I'm simply the recruiter. Welcome to the recruiter's office. There will be no physical agility test. There will be no written test. The test has already been passed by Jesus in his blood. You have the right to enter. If you wanna enter, come. All the way over here on the side. There's room up here at the altar, all the way in the sides, on my left and on my right. Come on, crowd in, crowd in. If you're in the aisle, make your way around. Tonight is a special and unique night. Bring your cell phone with you. Bring your iPad with you. If you don't have it, it's okay. If you have your cell phone in your pocket, I want you to take it out right now. Hold it up. Hold it up. In a moment, we're going to delete our apps, but I want you to get on Instagram right now. I want you to go to I Love Upper Room. If you already deleted, it's okay. On I Love Upper Room, there's a picture and it says consecrate. It says, as a part of Upper Room, I'm taking 21 days off social media to consecrate myself to God through prayer. I desire to know God and experience Him in my life. If I can pray for you during this time, please text me or call me. Okay, we made this for you so that you can screenshot it. Or go to the Repost app. Some of you guys are like, this doesn't seem very spiritual. This is very spiritual, trust me. Or you can go to Repost app or whatever you want. And together, let's post that. Somebody said sprint. It's on the Instagram. It's on our Facebook as well. Now here, if you have done that, that's great. I want you to do that before you delete your apps, okay? And make a declaration publicly that says, I'm going to stand out. I'm going to be a little different. I'm going to be a little different. I don't care who knows. I don't care. Because you make this public declaration, it's going to be a lot harder for you in 2 or 3 days to be like, oh, I'm going to get back on. Because all your friends are going to be like, hey, didn't you say that? I want your heathen friends to keep you accountable. Right? You need to look around. You need some people that will keep you accountable as well. So you post that, and then once you're ready, let's do this. For me, I got Snapchat, Periscope, Twitter, Facebook, Messenger, and Instagram right here. So let's do it. There goes Snapchat. There goes Periscope. My Twitter. Tweet, tweet, tweet. You're gone. Messenger. I'm not going to miss that one. That one's annoying. Facebook. I'm going to miss that sometimes. And my favorite one, Instagram. Peace. You gone. Anything else on there you need to delete? Do it now. For me, I got my YouTube app. Dude, Portlandia. Ouch. My SNL skits. Vine. Do it for the Vine, delete it. 21. What else? I'm not gonna need the Repost app. Delete that. What else you got? You guys know what you got. Delete it. What? Musical.ly? Can you get worship on that? No. eBay? Dang it, my daughter said eBay. She knows me. Dang, Alana, I like eBay. My daughter's calling me out on the front row. Go ahead, delete it. Ouch, really? Ah, okay. My girl knows me. She knows I like to get on eBay and find deals. I love it. Bargain shopper. I got these shoes on eBay for $8. The Aldos. I'm an eBay king. Anything else? If you have to wait because you want to repost it and you don't have service, that's fine. Once you've done that, I want to pray for you. And we anointed you with oil last week, and tonight is the beginning of our fast. Anybody that wants to, Fred, are you still in the building? Fred Rao? If you are, just come on up to the stage. Fred and Sue. Did they leave? Are they gone? Okay, that's fine. I'll pray for you. We'll anoint you. Any of our other leaders that want to, I encourage you, you can pray for each other and prophesy. The band, I'm going to ask you guys just play something real soft. And Julio, you're the best drummer in the world, but no drums. Just something real soft, just real quiet. And let's consecrate our hearts right now. Take a moment, and let's just start this thing off right. 21 days, beginning of our year. We're pulling out of the system. We're turning off. There's some music that needs to go. Dude, I don't just listen to worship music and read my Bible, okay? I like music. I like entertainment. I'm a pastor, but I'm a human as well. So there's some music I'm not going to be listening to. It's not necessarily bad, but I don't need to be hearing that right now. I'm going to listen to worship music. I'm going to read my Bible. I'm going to read some books that edify my spirit. I'm going to listen to some podcasts of some great preachers. You can get that app on your phone if you don't have it, podcast app. You can download messages from Upper Room for years back. You can listen to a message every day of this fast. You can listen to the greatest preachers in the whole world through your podcast app. There's so many things you can do to build up your spirit. I'm gonna take some time. I'm gonna go out probably up to the Jar Trail. I'm gonna do some hiking by myself. I'm gonna go up into the canyon. I'm gonna find some places just by myself. I'll take my Bible, I'll take my headphones, and I'm gonna let God speak to me. How many times do I keep my face in this thing and let the world speak to me? I'm gonna just say, God, what do you wanna say? God, I don't need any apps. I don't need any Netflix. I don't need any of this stuff right now. 21 days, you got my attention. What do you wanna say? Don't get frustrated if he doesn't all of a sudden just start speaking to you. He will. Be patient, tune in. Separate yourself. Maybe at work during your lunch, instead of sitting at the gossip table or going out with the friends, maybe that means you need to go find a place or sit in your car and snack on your carrots. I know, it stinks. I hate it too. But I promise you, as your pastor, as God's general over this movement, that he will produce something of great value in your life if you'll do this. I promise you that. I can promise you because it's in the Word. So all together now, we're gonna pray and we're gonna do this thing. Oh, Father. We come before you now, Lord. We are humbled. We humble ourselves through fasting and prayer. Over these next 21 days, I pray that you would speak to your people. Give them dreams, give them visions, give them the spirit of prophecy and every spiritual gift. Let them speak life. Let them prophesy. Let them speak in tongues. God, I pray that they would be drawn into your presence deeper, as deep calls unto deep, and rapids and breakers wash over in the presence of the King. Touch my friends. Do surgery on our hearts. God, I pray for miraculous signs and wonders. I pray if anyone here among us is sick, heal them. I pray if anyone among us is afflicted by evil spirit, deliver them. I pray that assignments over their life would be canceled. Generational bondages would be canceled. The spirit of alcoholism would be canceled. The spirit of depression would be canceled. The spirit of brokenness, demonic spirit of divorce that tells them they'll never have a good marriage, cancel it. Spirit of gluttony, canceled. King's stomach is no longer on the throne. Your Holy Spirit is on the throne of our hearts. Hallelujah, Jesus. Do your thing, God. Have your way. We say we are now holy and consecrated vessels. We may be weak, we may be frail, we may sin, we may fall short, Lord God, but right now we dedicate and we vow. We are yours, we are holy, we are consecrated. Whatever has been, whatever generational bondage or sin that is attached to us, I say, get off right now. We are no longer bound by sin and shame. We are no longer bound by the things that hold us. Addictions, Lord, I pray they would be broken. Even addictions to caffeines and sugars and artificial things, God, that our bodies crave. I pray that as our bodies wean off of those, that there would be no headaches and sickness, Lord, but we would feel fresh and anew. I pray for my friends to experience physical vitality like they've never experienced. I pray for energy and focus. I pray that they would outperform their peers at work. I pray that they would be called into the King's courts of their vocation, whoever that king may be. And they would be called on for wisdom, that they would be advanced like Daniel was. I pray that they would be advanced in their careers, in their school, that they'd have better test results, Lord God, that they'd have better outcomes on their projects that they're in charge of at work. I pray that their children, God, would understand them better. I pray for assignments over our children, Lord God, that they'd be canceled for our little ones and for the generations to come. I pray for influence in our city. And Father God, I pray for our state right now. God, and I pray for my friend. I pray for my friend Shannon Grove. As she represents us, Lord God, that you give her strength and wisdom and power to be a light of the gospel in a very dark place. encourage her in the spirit, Lord. I pray for the other leaders in our city that are Christians, Lord. I pray that you would help them, Lord. I pray for the president. I pray for Barack Obama, Lord Jesus. God, speak wisdom to him. Use him as an instrument of your glory. I pray for the leaders, God, whether they do things that I agree with or not, Lord God, I pray that you would bless them. I pray that you would give them favor because it says that you assign our leaders over us and turn our nation back to you. Turn the hearts of the children back to the hearts of the Father. I pray this all in your name, and I know it's according to your will. So I say very confidently, I pray a blessing of favor and wisdom and overflow on my friends. I can't touch every single one of you right now, so touch your neighbor on the shoulder. You're now my representative under God, and I want you to pray for your neighbor. I pray favor and blessing and strength and focus. I pray that you would give them the ability, Lord God, to complete this vow, this fast to you as a spiritual act, not to me, God, but even me, Lord God. I do it as unto you, Lord Jesus, God. We do it as unto you, Father. Lord, in your name, we thank you, Father, that we are more than conquerors and that we are able to do more than we could ever ask or imagine or conceive, anything that's ever entered into the hearts of man. Come on, take a moment and just pray for them. Pray for them. Pray for them right now. God, bless my neighbor. Come on, pray favor into their life. God, give them wisdom. Hallelujah, Jesus, Lord. Oh, I love you, God. Love you, Lord. As you finish, you may stand. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, as his assigned leader, I now commission you into this fast. You are equipped. You are strong enough. You are smart enough. You have the willpower. You can do it. In the name of the Lord, I speak this over your life. Every good and perfect thing, every spiritual gift is yours. In the name of the Lord now, I speak this under the authority of God Almighty in Jesus Christ. Amen.